Well, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
And welcome to March 2020. Today is because of the COVID-19, we now live in a world, and I think we all recognize this, that we live in a world that's far different pre-2020 for sure. Who could have ever imagined just touching change that you get back from paying a teller something, that could be the very place in which we will get infected with this new outbreak? It's unbelievable. When we think about the world of sports and we look around this world, and I know that some people are so saddened that there's no more NBA, but the whole spectrum of professional sports, the NHL, the Major League Baseball, football, soccer, lacrosse, almost every sport at a professional level, and even in the amateur levels, they're all now have been very much suspended and are standing still. And so one day we will look back to March 2020 and recognize that this COVID-19 outbreak really is a game changer. And I really believe that there is none of us here and nobody on this earth who will know what the future holds after COVID-19. It has been very much contained and managed in a much better way. And so this is history in the making. Nothing like this to this degree. I mean, when we think about the billions of dollars that professional sports generates, for them all to come to a suspension and a standstill, are you kidding me? Who could have ever have imagined that something could bring all of this to the standstill that we are? And so this game changer of an event in our lives is something that we will probably experience more and more as time goes on. We've been preaching through the book of Romans from the very beginning of this year, as you know. And this theme, from utter darkness to absolute light, is the theme in the book of Romans. And today we're going to learn, in Romans chapter 8, if you didn't know, Romans chapter 8 is one of the most well-known and one of the most beloved chapters in the entire Bible. And to recap chapters 1 to 7, basically, and I'm telling you, when Paul wrote the book of Romans, he brought some concepts to humanity that was a game changer for humanity. And in Romans chapters 1 to 7, he's teaching that all human beings ever have a corrupt and broken human nature, because inside of us we have this broken and tainted image of God. It all began in the Garden of Eden with Adam and Eve when they were banished from the garden because of their sin, and they were set into a broken world, a corrupt world now. And now God gives Moses the book of the law. He gives him the commandments as a guidebook to guide the covenant of God people, the people of God, how to live. The Mosaic law was always a guidebook for living. And what the law was supposed to do from the very beginning, it was given to the people of God. The law was always intended to be a guidebook that would teach us as human beings that it's impossible for anybody to fulfill 100%, and that in learning about how we cannot fulfill the law, we need to conclude as human beings we need God. And that was the purpose of the law, to be a teacher to the people, to show us that we have a corrupt inner being and that we need God more than anything else in all this entire world. And so in Romans chapter 7, right up to the very end, Paul has been all this time focusing on the weakness of the law. All the law could do was teach us that we need God, but what the law could not do was give us a way to come back to God. Salvation was never the intention of the law. The law was always intended to teach us of our absolute and utter need for the Heavenly Father. And so Paul in chapter 8, where we come to today, Paul's going to focus on the power and the gift of the Holy Spirit. And Paul's going to identify this Holy Spirit as the liberator of our sin. He's going to teach us about the Holy Spirit being the guarantor of our liberation and our resurrection and the hope that we have for glory in the end. So what we learn in Romans chapter 8, or what we're about to learn, is that without the indwelling Holy Spirit, salvation is not possible. Without the Holy Spirit in us, discipleship and transformation of character and being rebuilt in the image of God, it's not possible. In fact, without the Holy Spirit in us, we can never be true children of God. And so as we come to Romans chapter 8, and I'd like to invite you to turn there with me now. And as we open our Bibles and turn to Romans chapter 8, it's a beautiful, beautiful passage. And I'm going to read the first 11 verses here. This is such a power-packed chapter, Romans chapter 8. And here Paul writes in verses 1 to 11, "Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh. And for sin, he condemns sin in the flesh, in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk according to the who walk not according to the flesh, but according to his Spirit." Verse 5, "For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. For to set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God, for it does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. Those who are in the flesh cannot please God. You, however, are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If, in fact, the Spirit of God dwells in you, anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through the Spirit, through his Spirit who dwells in you." Wow. So here in chapter 8, there's an overarching theme, and a lot of people think that Romans chapter 8 is all about sanctification, growing in holiness, and to some degree that is an emphasis of chapter 8. But I think that when we look at chapter 8 here, there's another overarching theme that Paul is writing about. And that overarching theme is often mixed. And I want to show you what I think is the overarching theme here. In this uncertain and unchanging world, there is only one absolute security, and that is life in God and in God alone. This is what I think is the overarching theme of Romans chapter 8. In this uncertain and ever-changing world, there is only one absolute security, and that is life in God and in God alone. Here we find another one of Paul's therefores, because we've been learning in the book of Romans, whenever you see a therefore, it's a very important introduction for what's about to take place. Previously, the previous therefore that we found in Paul's writing was in Romans chapter 5. He said, "Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God." And Paul puts that chapter 5, verse 1 in a very positive way. Because we are justified by faith, it is we who are justified by faith that we have peace with God. And now in Romans chapter 8, in our passage in verse 1 here, he says, "Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus." And so what we're going to learn in chapter 8 here, beginning in verse 1, I mean, the first blessing of salvation is very clear here, that a Christian is already justified, and if you are a true Christian, you'll never ever be rejected and end up in a hell that was always destined for those who are not children of God. It's a promise and a guarantee here, and that's the first blessing. We who are children of God will never ever be rejected by God and sent to an eternal hell.
where all those who are without Christ will be sent. But there's another blessing here with the salvation. And if you take a look at verse 2 to 4 here again, and this is a beautiful, beautiful three verses here. Verse 2, for the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death or eternal death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not or ever do. By sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh for sin, he condemned sin in the flesh in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. So the blessing here, it's so clear. The law of the Spirit has set the Christian free from the law of death and the law of sin. It truly is such a gift to be a child of God. You see, in the mind of Paul here, there is definitely a liberation that has taken place when we become a child of God. And there's this guarantee that he gives to everyone who is truly indeed a child of God. There is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And I'm sitting here thinking that as we may be visiting here, or if we just happen to come and we're observing these verses that Paul is writing here in chapter 8, I mean, just like the Jewish people who were his first audience when he wrote the book of Romans, the people, the Jewish people hearing or reading the book of Romans are thinking, are you serious? Really, Paul? All you need to do is to believe in Jesus Christ. Is that all that needs to be done? Is there all that is to it? Just believe in Jesus and everything will be okay. You'll be free from the law of sin. You'll be free from death. Just believe in Jesus. And it just sounds so simple or so simplistic, so easy. It's almost as if there's nothing that needs to be done. Paul, what about it? And when we look at and read carefully the text that Paul has written, I mean, the truth of the matter, it's not easy peasy. It's not all that easy. It's not that simple. Someone has gone to great lengths. Someone has gone to enormous energy to make it possible for humans to come back to God and to be free from the power of sin and death. And so we need to ask ourselves, well, and Paul's very clear, he's pointing to God as the one who's done all this for us. It's not us who have done a lot, it's God who has done a lot. And so what about it, Paul? What has he done to secure this promise of no condemnation? What has he done to make us righteous in his sight? And so that's the million-dollar question today, in a sense. What did God do to secure this liberation and to secure this freedom and to make it possible for us humans to come back to him and to have the ability and the power to say no to sin and to say yes to God? And so there are four very, very clear things here that God did, four actions that God went to such an extent to do to give us this opportunity to come back to him. And so the first thing that we can see what Paul did is in verse 3, the sending of his own Son. Here in verse 3 it says, for God has done what the law weakened by the flesh could never do by sending his own Son. By sending his own Son. I mean, think about that phrase for a moment. Jesus Christ, very Son of God, as the triune God in the perfections of heaven, ruling together as a triune God, and for the Father to ask the Son to leave the perfections of heaven. I mean, and for Jesus to say yes, I mean, that is an astronomical thing. I mean, and it's not like Jesus didn't know what he was doing. It's not like he didn't know that he was going to die for sinful people. I mean, for us, would we die for someone we love? It's possible. You could love your children, you could love your spouse, you could love somebody so much that you jump in front of that freight train to save their life. You might do that. But to die for the people that you do not like and are enemies of you, for anyone, could anyone, would anyone, is there anyone here who would actually die for your enemy? And I think we all know the answer, but Jesus was willing. God asked the second person of the triune God to go, and Jesus went. It's an amazing, amazing thing. The second thing that God took action was not only did he just send his son, but Jesus had to incarnate. He had to take on human flesh. He had to become like human to be able to come into our human world. Look at verse 3 again. For God has done what the law weakened by the flesh could not do by sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh. And so again, it was not easy peasy. It was not like just nothing happened. No. Jesus had to take on human form. I mean, think about that. He had to leave the perfections of heaven, come to our earthly form and to our earthly world. I mean, would you ever think about being willing to go into a lower species? I mean, if in a hypothetical world, if someone asked you, hey, would you like to become a snake? Would you like to become a dog? Would you like to become a chicken? To leave all that you have and all of our fallen humanity and to become what? A lower species? Who here would be willing to do that if that could take place? Not a chance any of us would be willing to give up what we currently possess and to basically give up everything in life to go to a war-torn world in which you know they're going to hate you, they're going to reject you, they're going to kill you, they're going to crucify you with the worst kind of death. Really, really, I mean, who would ever do that? It wasn't easy peasy. A third action that God took was number 3. I mean, Jesus went knowing that he would be a sin offering. Again, in verse 3 it says here, for God had done what the law weakened by the flesh could never do by sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh for sin. He knew that he would be born to die and to be a living sacrifice to die, not for his sins, but for the sins of the world. It's unbelievable. It's unbelievable. Really, it is. Who would ever be willing to go die and to die a most horrific death for your enemies? Now, Jesus would. God asked and Jesus submitted. The fourth, the unbelievable extent to what God had went to make this guaranteed freedom and this no condemnation of reality and the truth for us. The fourth thing was God had to ensure that he would satisfy the righteous requirements of the law. Look here at verses 3 and 4. For God has done what the law weakened by the flesh could not do by sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh. And for sin, he condemned the sin in the flesh in order that the righteous requirements of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. You see, God did not just overlook everything and just ignore and brush the sin of humanity under the carpet and simply say, you are forgiven. Because he could have did that. Isn't that what we do when someone offends us or sins against us? We don't always want to talk about it. We don't always want to deal with it. We don't always want to make it right. We just say, oh, you're forgiven. And we don't really take care of reconciliation the way God takes care of reconciliation. He makes sure that the righteous requirements of the law are fulfilled. He doesn't just brush all the sin under the rug and cover. No. He makes sure that his own law, the righteous requirements of it, are fulfilled. And what it took to be fulfilled is for a perfect and sinless sacrifice. And God knew that. God asked Jesus to go to earth to be that sin offering because Jesus didn't die for his sins. He died for our sins. We might be willing to brush everyone's sin under the rug and not to talk about it and just say you're forgiven and the whole bitterness in our heart. That's how most of us deal with people who offend us. No. That's not God. for our sins to be fully forgiven, the righteous requirements of the law had to be fulfilled. God could not and would not and would never just say you're forgiven and forget about the righteous requirements of the law. Anything short of a sinless and perfect sacrifice would not count and could not bring us back to God. Jesus, the divine Son, the perfect and sinless Savior, it was the only way. It was the only way. And so it's challenging for us when we think about Jesus leaving the perfections of heaven, coming to earth, to be put to death, not for his sins, but for our sins. And all of this took centuries. I mean, it didn't happen overnight. Well, in order that the righteous requirements of the law might be fulfilled. So when we think about all of this, what was the purpose of all of this? Why did God go to such incredible and amazing extent in his actions for all, what, why, for what purpose? The answer is given to us in Paul here. For what purpose? So that we would walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For what purpose? It is to walk a life in the Spirit. And when we see this phrase here in the book of Romans and the entire New Testament, when he talks or when any author talks about walking in the Spirit, the author is always talking about growing in our life of holiness. Practical holiness, everyday holiness. Why did God do all of this? So that we would walk in the Spirit and grow every day in the holiness that we have here on this earth. And so to the mind of the human being, I mean, it's just unthinkable and unbelievable. But for those of us who come to know who God is, this holy and perfect God, and when we recognize, as Paul has been teaching us in Romans 1-7, that we have a corrupt nature, we cannot help but to sin. Yes, we can do good every once in a while, but in the end, we cannot help but to sin. We don't have the power nor the ability to live a life of holiness, and that's what the law proves. Hundreds of years it's proven we cannot fulfill the law. And so, to live a life in the Spirit is to live a life of holiness. A true child of God, a true follower of Jesus Christ, is a person who has been reborn, in which at our conversion, the Holy Spirit comes into us, indwells in us, lives in us, and transforms us each and every day. And so we become Holy Spirit-led, and we become Holy Spirit-controlled for those who are true children of God. And I say to that, amen. Isn't that an amen? It's not me creating the holiness, because I can't do it. The flesh is still here. But the Spirit that is in me is the one who is able to transform me and to rebuild the original image of God that God has always intended in us, so that we can reflect his glory and his holiness more and more as we live out our lives on this earth. I remember being invited to my first church fellowship as a non-Christian. My brother, Ray, was the one who invited me when I moved up to Toronto from Windsor to his church. And he was the first convert, the first Christian in our family lineage. And when I moved up here, I had never gone to church. I knew nothing about Christianity. But he invited me to his church fellowship, and so I went. And I can still remember in this group of young people, 35 to 40 was the number. We'd have a fellowship program on a Saturday morning, and then we'd have lunch together. I've never been there, so I went. Had an interesting time listening to their first program. After the program was over, was fellowship lunch, and it was great. And during this fellowship lunch, you know, people were asking me about myself and asking me who I am and what do I do, and we're just chit-chatting away. And I can still remember the most horrific look on my brother's face when we started talking, and the fellowship people were asking me all kinds of questions, and he said, tell us a little bit about yourself. And I can still remember this as clear as day. I started pulling out my lottery tickets. I goes, wow, you know, I hope someday to win $1 million, I'll never have to work again. It'd be great. It's only a couple bucks. And I can remember glancing over at my brother. He had the most horrific look on his face. And I knew when I looked at him, there was something wrong. I mean, the fellowship people there were very kind and they were very generous. They went, mm-hmm, mm-hmm, okay, mm-hmm. Oh, we gotcha, yeah, thank you, yeah, we understand. But the look on my brother's face, I knew there was something wrong. If I could read his mind, he was saying, you idiot! Put that stuff away! And back then, as a non-Christian, I didn't know that it was bad or wrong or lacking in faith to have lottery tickets, but I sure learned after I became a Christian that all of the stuff like buying lottery tickets, going to casinos, drinking and smoking and doing drugs and swearing and hating on people, I knew that those were things that children of God will eventually get rid of in their life if it exists at all. It is a part of our sinful nature. It is a part of our selfishness and greed. It is a part of a life that God needs us not to be participating in. And so back then, I didn't realize all of that, but the things that I was involved with as a non-Christian were very, very common among people who know nothing about God or nothing about morals or morality, who knew nothing about holiness. But I do know for sure, and we do know for sure in Romans chapter 8, that the hallmark of a true and authentic Christian in Jesus Christ is a life that is slowly and sometimes quickly transformed into a life of holiness and glory in Jesus Christ. And where there is an absence of a desire and an absence of a transformation in holiness, it's very likely and very possible that this person may not be a true Christian. Because those who do have the Holy Spirit indwelling in us, even as I may fight the Holy Spirit against holy and righteous things, eventually the Holy Spirit transforms us and does that work in us. We can't even fight it. But it sure helps a lot when we submit to it and participate in the program of God to be able to become more and more holy in our walk on this earth. And so we think about what Paul's writing here in chapter 8 and what we need to recognize and what we need to ask Paul in chapter 8. Well, if this is the case, if we are to live a life indwelt by the Spirit, transformed by the Spirit, led by the Spirit, how? What suggestions do you have, Paul? What are our battle plans? What do you suggest for us to activate the power and the life of the Spirit in us so that we can accelerate our growth in holiness? And so I think when we look carefully at Romans chapter 8, in verses 5 to 17, Paul actually gives us strategic plans to be able to begin to implement in our lives that if we want to grow in holiness, these are things that must take place. So look with me at verses 5 to 17, because this is a key section in Romans chapter 8 that we can discover the battle plans from Paul. And so here it is in verse 5. And let's look at this very carefully. Verse 5. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on what? On the things of the flesh. But those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, nor indeed can be. So then, those who are in the flesh cannot please God, but you are not in the flesh, but you, children of God, are in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. Now, if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he is not his. He is not Jesus's. He is not God's. Verse 10, and if Christ is in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. But if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. Therefore, brethren, We are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if you live by the Spirit, you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are sons or daughters of God. For you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If indeed we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together. And so Paul leaves us with some direction, and he leaves us with some active steps that we must take if we are to mortify, or in other words, to slay, to put to death the misdeeds of our body. And so when we think about battle plans or strategic application or directives from Paul here, it's very clear that Paul spends a good portion of verses 5 to 17 negatively speaking about the misdeeds of the body, and he speaks positively about living in the Spirit. So the first thing that we can kind of summarize in this little section is, negatively stated, Paul is calling us to totally repudiate, to reject, to put to death all that is wrong in the sight of God. All that is wrong in the sight of God. To repudiate is rejecting totally. And not rejecting it tomorrow, not rejecting it next week, not rejecting it next month, but rejecting it immediately. Immediately, right now, right away. The first thing that he suggests is that we must abstain from even thinking. We must stop and kill any thoughts that come to our mind that we know are not in the will of God. Because when a thought and a temptation comes to our mind, most of us are already thinking about, and we're going to think a little bit of how to gratify the desires of our flesh. It's true. What Paul is saying, don't even linger. Don't even think, not even for one more second, about how to gratify and give into our temptations. We Christians, and he's saying this very clearly, we must mortify, we must put to death, we must be ruthless, we must be 100% committed that when an evil thought comes to our mind, that's the time to stop it, kill it, take it away. Because if we don't, if we do not, if we linger with it, if we toy with it, if we think about it, if we dwell on it, sin has already captured our heart. And when sin captures our heart, it will steal us away from God. And our heart will no longer be 100% committed to honoring God, to submitting to the Spirit, to follow God, but our hearts will dwell in our little pockets of secrecy and will give into the sin. And we will become a prisoner of sin, and it will capture us and hold us captive and will never want to let us go. Paul is saying his first strategic action, if you want to live by the Spirit and live in the Spirit and live with the Spirit, to be led by the Spirit, to be transformed by the Spirit, when that comes, immediately, cut it off, rip it out, chop it off, run and flee from that evil thought, because the longer it sits in our brain, it's going to eventually get to our hearts and hold us captive. And so Paul is telling us here, why? Why do we want to cooperate with sin when it comes knocking at our door? And I really believe that most of us, it's not that we sin by accident. It's that when sin is knocking at the heart and knocking at our door, we kind of look at it. We may kind of think about it. We may resist it for a few moments, but we're still thinking about it later on. Captured us. We're already a prisoner of war, and it's only a matter of time before we open that door and we let the sin come into our hearts or the temptation. And now we are fully involved with things of the flesh.
There's no doubt, no question about it. We are captured. And our heart is getting, with every passing moment, further and further and further away from God. And so Paul is teaching us, no. Get rid of that temptation. Get rid of that thought as soon as possible before it captures our heart. That's how sin works. And so rather than talking about it negatively, Paul actually does something here that we should all learn from. We can never just take something and remove it, and then we go on with life. No. If we want to overcome those temptations and those sinful thoughts and desires, not only must we remove it, but we must replace it with something if we are to have success over the long term. And so positively stated, Paul says here in the verse here, he says to instead set your mind and your heart on the things above, here in verse 8, or verse 5, I should say. So in verse 5, Paul is comparing, and he's turning it into a positive terminology. Instead of giving into it, now let's be positive and proactive. Take it out, kill it, put it dead, and replace it with something that is from the Spirit, that is righteous, that is holy. And so we are to set our minds on the things above and to set our minds on the things from the Spirit. And I love this open sharing that we had at the beginning of the worship service because, my friends, Scripture is truth. Scripture is what we need to fill our minds with. Truth is what we need to set our minds in. When we are tempted by sin, and I'm tempted to think and to possibly hang on to what I'm about to do as being sin, I need to get rid of that, and now I need to turn 180 degrees and fill that void with truth, with the Spirit of God, spiritual things, holy things, righteous things. And most of you know that, and I've talked with a lot of us here at SCOM. One common verse that we all hold dearly to our hearts comes from Paul's own writing, Philippians chapter 4, verse 8. I love the Philippians passage that was read about rejoice always, chapter 4, verses 3 to 7. But when we pick up what Paul says in Philippians chapter 4, verse 8, he summarizes it, and Paul says, finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, and whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. When those evil things come into our minds and when those temptations are there in our mind or in our brain or in our thoughts, remove it, kill it, mortify it, slay it, remove it, and think. Replace that void with the truth of God. And what does verse 9 says? Eventually at the end of verse 9, and when you think about such things, then God's peace can be with us. It's an amazing promise that when we think and focus on such things that are holy and pure and from the Spirit, then we need not worry about anything. Then we can hold fast to the holiness that God wants all of us to be. So Paul's declaration here in Romans chapter 8, he's telling us that nothing in all this world can take us and separate us from the love that is in God through Jesus Christ. Nothing can snatch us and take us away from the hand of God, not even COVID-19. There's nothing in all this world that can separate us and to interfere with God's plans for each and every one of our lives. So again, when we think about Romans chapter 8 here, we come back to this overarching theme, this prime directive that I said from the beginning. In this uncertain and ever-changing world, there is only one absolute security and guarantee in life, and that is our life in God and in God alone. Today, as we think about coming here to worship God, living a life of holiness and freedom from sin, may all of us here be found to be in Jesus Christ for real, so that as a child of God,
we can seek to live together by His Spirit and for His glory, even in the midst of our uncertain world. Let's close in prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for today. We thank you that somehow this virus, COVID-19 outbreak around this world has brought us all to a standstill. And in many ways, it's bringing many of us to our knees. It has affected every country around this world, and it's only starting. And so, God, we come to you this morning, and we are so thankful that we are still able to worship you. Thank you for the faith that we have in Jesus Christ and for the opportunity to come back to you and to give you our lives to you and to you alone. Lord, we pray for your grace. We pray for your mercy. In this time of uncertainty, we pray that you would help us to live strong for Jesus Christ by your Spirit and by your grace, that we would be a light unto this darkened world in the midst of all this panic and fear, that in Jesus we have peace, we have protection, and we are guaranteed of no condemnation because we have been declared righteous by you. So we thank you for the salvation that we have. We thank you for the opportunities of saying no to sin and saying yes to your Spirit and to be a shining light that perhaps you can use to draw others into the kingdom of Jesus Christ, that this world that is now standing still will perhaps see another way, Jesus Christ, because he is the way, he is the truth, and he is the light. So Lord, we simply pray this morning that you would reign supreme in each of us more and more with every passing minute, not because we are smart, not because we are strong, but because you are the God of all grace. Continue to be with us now, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Victor. Let's take the time to respond to God's word and invite the Spirit of the living God to come and fall afresh on us, to come and reign in us each.